Last time, we have completed the title screen, but obviously it was only for a show and we couldn't interact with the program in any way. This time, we're going to jump right into how to implement the handling of user input. I do want to mention that this is probably going to be the most opaque part of the program, and it's not necessarily because it is hard to understand as far as logic is concerned. It is just that there's some low-level details that most people are probably going to feel uncomfortable writing from the point of view of a game designer. So I do apologize for this in advance, and I'll do my best to explain this part. And even if at the end that you don't feel you fully understand, don't just get discouraged or feel like you have to memorize it. It is okay to just treat it as somewhat of a black box, as we will be encapsulating this with some functions. As usual, let me first check in the code changes and kind of explain that what we're dealing with here. All right. So normally I will do a demo first, but for this, I do think it is easier to kind of hear the theory. So here's the thing. On a terminal, the user interacts with the program through a default file descriptor, typically referred to as a standard in, which is for inputs. There's also a standard out file descriptor that handles output, which we have been using all along with printf, and that's how things are printed to the screen. To read user input or key presses, we basically have to do it via the standard in file, but there's a catch with the default terminal setting, which is also called the canonical mode. By default, the standard in file is line buffered, meaning that the input will not be available for read until a line feed is encountered. So some of you might remember using functions such as scanf to get what the user is typing on the terminal. And then the thing is, the program will basically block as it waits for you to type in the characters. And then once you hit the enter button, the program will then resume and then the input will be delivered to the program. And that's what I mean by line buffered. The underlying terminal IO handler will keep everything that the user types inside some internal memory. And then only when user hits enter, the input then becomes available to readers of that standard in file. And it's obvious that this won't fit our use case here, right? Just imagine how terrible the user experience will be if they have to be hitting enters all the time to get their key presses registered. Nobody will play a game like that. I mean, if you have a turn-based game, like some text adventure or tic-tac-toe, you can probably use canonical mode and be all right, but for an action-oriented game, absolutely not. Therefore, we must switch to something called a non-canonical mode, where instead of giving the user input to the program line by line, we want to read from standard in character by character between frame pauses with minimum delay. So if we take a look at this code, in the main function, let's first check this set non-canonical mode function, which I just explained that we need. There is a terminal structure, which is kind of like a configuration for the terminal's IO. What we want to do is to change the way the standard in works. So we first use this function tcgetAdder to copy the default standard in settings into the struct. We make a bunch of modifications and then we set it back to apply the changes. The configurations are mostly controlled by bit flags, and these are certainly hard to read even with named symbols. For example, here we are clearing the iCanon bit to set non-canonical mode. Don't feel obligated to memorize all these flags. Just remember that at the end, we want to be able to access the user's input immediately after they type. So if you're interested, just go ahead and read the documentation on these flags. But if not, that's fine. Just treat it as a black box. In the main function, before the game starts, we are calling this function to get our terminal ready. And you can see that I'm also saving the terminal state aside before we call. And that's because we want to reset it back after the game ends. Otherwise, you're stuck with a non-canonical terminal if the game exits normally, which is probably not what you want. To read the user's input, we use this getInputChar function, which is quite simple. We just use the read function on standard in into this input buffer, which I declared here with a size of 256, which should be more than enough. Now, after the read, you also notice that we are going to return just the last character from the buffer as the user's key press. And that's because we only get a chance to process input between frames. And if someone's typing too fast, we choose a single key as a response to kind of slow it down, because trying to process all characters will likely make the game unnaturally responsive. Our game runs at 15 FPS, which means we can process 15 different key presses in a second, which I feel is sufficient for something like this. But you will start to notice that the game will become more and more unresponsive as we decrease the FPS. In this game, the game's speed is also tied to FPS, so we can't just blindly increase this value to adjust responsiveness, because that will, you know, for example, also cause the enemies to start moving crazy fast. In a real game, I think, well, I'm not a game dev at all in my profession, so don't necessarily quote me on this, but I'd imagine that you should probably decouple the graphics rendering from the game loop itself, so that a game running at a higher FPS just means that the transitions are now smoother, not actually having the game running at a higher speed, which will be kind of weird. But this is a simple game, so we're gonna keep it simple. I also added this line here inside the frame pause function to throw out unprocessed characters so that our standard in starts clean every cycle. To see this in action, we come down to the run title screen function. The loop is exactly the same, and now we're reading one character each frame, and then we do some processing. Here, we're just going to check if the character is either a Q or E to change the game state, and then just end the function, and then we ignore all other characters. The game state is an enum that I declared here on the top. Currently, we only care about a few of them here, and then we use this as a global indicator to switch between the title screen and the actual game, which we're going to write in a moment. And then when this function returns, you can see that we're just going to end the program. So now when I test this, I can press either Q or E, and then the game will quit. It's obviously not super useful at the moment, but then the important thing is that we have established the infrastructure for input control, and we will be using these functions throughout the game later. And then finally, this one line here is just to set a seed for a random number generator that we're going to use later. Okay, so we got the boring part out of the way. We can start to do some more interesting things. Previously, even if we press E to start the game, the program ends, and that's obviously not what we want. So we want to define an inner loop to host the actual gameplay. So let me first bring in that code. And it is going to start very simple. Our gameplay loop will just draw a tank at the bottom right, and that's it. So this is the code, and I'll quickly demo it. If I press E here, and you can see there's a tank that's being rendered at the bottom right, and nothing else works, but I can still quit the game with Q. Let's take a look at this code. In the main function, we wrap our game functions now inside a while loop, which will run forever until the user decides to quit, which will then set the game state to ended. Until that happens, we first run our title screen, obviously, to initialize the game, and then if the user decides to press E to start the game and set the game state to playing, we'll then call this run game function, which starts the gameplay loop. Otherwise, we break out the loop as well, since the only other state possible is ended. So now the good thing is that we can essentially delegate our game logic to just the run game function without having to modify the main function too much from now on. As I said before, as a first step, we just want to draw our player tank. Now before we draw, we must first define the tank. So here you can see I have declared a few enums at the top that represents directions as well as the object type. We are obviously only interested in the tank type for now, but later we will introduce enemies as well as bullets, which are the two other objects that we need to draw. And here is some definitions for the tank and some ugly ASCII art for how to draw the tank in all four directions. The tank struct itself has things like the row and column of its top right character in its 5x3 hitbox. The direction, the object type, we're not going to worry about the CD and the move at the moment. And we come down here. I'll explain the draw function in a bit, but let's first go over the high level of the run game function. We first create the tank object with default values, setting its direction to up, and then the row and column to the screen's bottom right, right? And then here you can see that we are going to start to use some of the variables that we have declared at the very beginning of that first video, so we are not going to manually put in some very hard to read numbers. We are subtracting the tank's own width and height here because the row and column correspond to the top left of the tank, and thus we need to shift a few characters. After that, we see a very similar loop structure as in the run title screen function. we read the user's input and then try to process it during each frame, and then with a render pause sequence at the end. Input processing part is very straightforward. If the user hits Q, we change the game state to ended and then return from the function. Otherwise, we keep it running. Remember what I emphasized in the previous video, the core game loop is to read input, apply game state, set the screen's memory, and then render, right? So here, we're doing the memory setup using screen fill def to just draw the empty border, and then calling the draw object function to just put the tank into that screen memory, and then everything else just works as is. So now let's take a look at the draw object function, which is very important to the game as it will be responsible for drawing pretty much everything in the game loop. It takes in a void pointer, which just means it can be any pointer, similar to any or unknown type if you are familiar with languages like TypeScript. But a void pointer must be cast into a concrete type before it can be used. And this is how you can do some object-oriented programming in C. All of our game objects, as you will see later with enemies and bullets as well, will have this object type as the first field on their struct, and thus it makes it safe for us to first cast this unknown pointer into that enum, and then we're going to just switch to different code branches based on what that enum value is. Now, we're obviously leaving the enemy and the bullet branch empty as we haven't created them, but in the tank branch, since now we have already identified the object type, it makes then safe for us to cast this pointer into a tank pointer type, and then we will use this to get data on the current state of the tank, such as its coordinates. The switch statement checks for the tank's current direction. Remember, the tank is drawn differently based on the direction that it is facing, right? So in the up case, we go line by line using the tank's height, and then we mem copying the ASCII content into the appropriate positions of the screen. And this is very similar to how we print the title screen, if you recall. The logic here is not hard at all, but you do need to be careful about the indices and make sure that things are not drawn out of bounds. I hope that the code is at least relatively easy to read and, you know, understand what my intention is. And then here we are just repeating the same for all other directions. The only thing that is changed is the source of the ASCII art content. And later on, you will see a lot more of these types of switch statements. And we're handling things just slightly differently based on the directions. So some of this code might seem long, but in reality, once you understand one case, the rest is more or less the same, just with small tweaks. And my explanation will also mostly focus on just a single case, so I don't waste your time on the same logic. This draw function is also very simple to call. Just invoke it directly with a reference, of whatever object that you want to draw. And that's how we're going to put objects into the screen and have it rendered. So we have a tank now. Let's move on to the next part, which is to draw enemies. And this is going to be super easy as long as you understood what I just explained. I'm not going to waste too much time here, just gonna check in the code and then kind of show it to you. Like I said, this is gonna be ultra simple, and we're using very similar strategies. All right, so the changes on the top is, these are just a bunch of definitions for the enemy, similar to what we have done for the tank, right? And similarly, some of these are not going to be used until the next video, so don't worry about a few of these fields just yet. But you should notice that it also has the object type, the row and the column, the directions, just like that tank. One notable difference is that to make things simpler, I'm just going to use a single set of ASCII art for all four directions of the enemy. So the direction here doesn't affect how enemies are rendered, just how they move. Nothing else is really changing here. And then in the draw function, I just added the code for the enemy branch. Very similar to the tank, we're getting the coordinates and then putting the enemy body into the screen's memory. At the beginning, we're also checking if the enemy is still alive, because we don't want to render once that the player has shot down. Now, I know I haven't implemented the combat mechanism yet, but I'll explain the gameplay in depth in the next video. And then in the run game function, once again, just like the tank, we first create their instances, But instead of creating one, we're creating a bunch based on enemy size. So we got a loop here. And then we're also calling the drawObject function on each of these enemies. Now, one difference is that we want to spawn those at the top and not having them overlap. So the column field here is going to be set based on the enemy's index that increments by 1 plus enemy's width. And then in the Y position, I am going to use the RNG to randomly select the location within the first 10 rows. So then when I start a game, for example here, then you see that the enemies are not always initialized in the same locations. And I can run again to prove it, right? And then you should see different placements. Yeah. Now, before I end this video, again, I wanted to just add a small extra feature to make us be able to control the direction that the tank is facing to get us ready for movement controls. I'll first bring that code and show it to you. And the change is going to be quite short too. All right. So if I run this, now you can see that the tank is switching directions in response to my key presses. Again, just like last time, I want you guys to maybe use this as a practice to kind of see if you understood some of the concepts I just talked about and know how to apply them. So feel free to pause the video here and think for maybe a few minutes on how would you implement this using the functions that we have just set up. The answer will be right here. Remember, during the gameplay loop, we are already reading the user input on every single frame before we draw and then render the objects. So here, we simply need to add a few more switch cases. If the user presses any of the WSD keys, we will change the direction field on that tank accordingly. And that's basically it. Our draw function will handle the rest. Don't worry about this move field just yet. This is eventually going to be how we implement movements. But just to briefly explain, basically if the user presses a directional key and then our tank is already facing that same direction, then we want the tank to move towards that direction by setting the move to true as a boolean, which makes sense, right? Originally, I wanted to touch upon movements in this video too, but to safely implement movements, we need to be able to handle collision and also be able to check if objects are already at the screen boundaries, which will be too long to explain here. So we will go over those things in the next video, but I believe we already have a pretty solid foundation, so it wouldn't be too difficult to write as long as we have collision detection in place. And then the collision detection really is, I think, the trickiest logic for this game. And then there are probably many ways to do that depending on your strategy. And I will present my trick, which I hope is relatively easy and, you know, to understand and use, even though it might be considered a bit hacky. Anyhow, that's it for now. I hope you are still interested, and we will finish up our game in the next video.